Hello, my name is Russ Euken, Extension Livestock Specialist with Iowa State University. Today we want to visit with you about using corn silage in feedlot diets. Certainly corn silage is not a new feed for most feedlot operators. However, in 2012 we might have a few issues that we want to look at with corn silage. Certainly this year, at least in Iowa, we probably had more corn silage that was harvested due to drought. Some of that corn silage might have a little lower energy value than normal. And we certainly have higher priced corn, mainly due to drought conditions and lower yields. The other thing we want to look at with corn silage is this something we can use that has more energy per acre than a corn grain harvest. We'll look at that question. As corn price does increase, is corn silage more economical? Certainly corn silage is a feed that will fit with a lot of feedlots that have their own crop operation or that can produce their own feed or corn silage. And finally, we want to look at some of the synergy that exists with some of the corn co-products and corn silage. To look at the energy per acre, we can simply assume some yields here, 180 bushel corn. We're going to harvest some corn stalks, maybe one and a half tons of corn stalks per acre, and 20 ton of corn silage is what we're going to operate for assumptions. And assuming some dry matter and TDN, we can see that just the corn grain has about 7,700 pounds of total digestible nutrients, or TDN. We might get about 1,200 pounds of TDN from the corn stalks, or a total between the corn stalks and corn grain of about 8,900 pounds of TDN. If we harvested 20 ton of corn silage off that acre, we might get about 9,800 pounds of TDN. So in most cases, I think we can say we're going to harvest more energy per acre. And if we're going to feed that to cattle, we typically have more beef per acre then as well. But what about the corn silage value as compared to corn grain? Typically, since corn grain can be marketed readily, we try to compare most feeds to corn grain. Same with corn silage. So if we start trying to compare it to corn grain, we can base it on the feed value. If we were buying it, that would primarily be what we'd be looking at. Or if we were selling corn silage, we'd be looking at the opportunity cost. What's the opportunity of selling corn grain and corn stalks versus selling corn silage, in other words? From those two values, we'd subtract or mainly subtract harvesting and storage cost, and probably add fertilizer, any additional fertilizer removal that we might have with corn silage. We won't go into all the math today, but there is a spreadsheet that's available through Ag Decision Maker. William Edwards at Iowa State University developed this spreadsheet. You can see the website there to go get that spreadsheet. And in that spreadsheet, you can put in your harvesting cost, the fertilizer removal, price of the fertilizer per pound, as well as the feed value or the market price of corn, market price of corn stalks, and it'll calculate both the feed value and the opportunity cost. So you kind of have a window of what that price may be for corn silage compared to corn grain. Typically, we've looked at that as far as a price times corn per bushel. And if we want to look at the feed value price that we would estimate from that corn silage pricer spreadsheet, typically that's higher than the opportunity cost. And when I ran some approximate numbers through there, the feed value was about 11 times the price of corn per bushel. However, the opportunity costs were lower relative to corn price, and also that factor times the corn price per bushel gets lower as the corn price increases, and that's typically because the harvesting cost and fertilizer price don't change as much as what that corn price does. That may not be true in all situations, but in this case, that's what we looked at. And so the opportunity cost was 10.5 times the price of corn per bushel at $3 and 8.5 times the price of corn per bushel at $8 per bushel. So obviously how we price corn silage is going to make a big difference on how it fits into rations, but this just gives you a little background on that. So if we start looking at corn silage and feedlot rations, we wanted to consider some longer backgrounding periods. How does corn silage look in finishing rations? We kind of know that higher levels of corn silage do decrease feedlot performance. We're not going to be feeding as much concentrate or as energy dense of ration, so the feedlot performance does go down. It does deteriorate when we have higher levels of corn silage. But what about the economics? And what about if we're feeding higher levels of distillers with the corn silage? This fall, we came out with a new publication. You can see the publication there on the screen, and the website at the bottom is where you can get this publication. Basically, it looks at corn silage in extended backgrounding rations from 500 to 1,000 pounds. And the first page of the sheet that you can, of the publication that you can see on the screen here, also looks at some actual research information on starting calves on feed with corn silage compared to a typical concentrate. Won't go into the details there, but just we'll say that the research showed that calves can successfully be started on corn silage as well as those concentrate type rations. So that information would be there for you to review. One of the things that we did, looking here at 2012 and some silage that was harvested due to drought, we wanted to compare different amount of drought stress in this corn silage. In this case, we estimated what the energy level of that drought silage would be. So in this table, we've got slight drought stress, which would be about 95% of the energy of normal corn, and some severe drought stuff, which is down around 80% energy of normal corn silage. And then we looked at rations with three levels of silage in those rations. One was an 80% silage, no corn. The rest was distiller's grains, or 20% distiller's grains. We had one with 55% silage, 25% distiller's grains, and the rest corn, and then 20% silage on a dry matter basis, 25% distiller's grains, and 55% corn. And you can see those, how the days on feed, average daily gain, feed efficiency, and then the amount of silage and corn that would be used with both the slight drought stress and severe drought stress corn. So again, performance does go down. Daily gain, feed efficiency are both poorer for the higher silage rations than those that have the higher level of corn in there. However, when we looked at cost of gain, this is using normal corn silage. And in this case, we again looked at the all silage or 80% silage ration, 20% distiller's grains, a ration with 20% corn, 25% distiller's grains, rest corn silage. And so you can see how cost of gain changes as we put more corn in the ration. The blue bars represent $7 a bushel of corn, the red bars $8 a bushel of corn, and the green bars $9 a bushel of corn. And in this case, we priced the silage at 9 times the price of corn, and we had a 35 cent per head per day yardage in there. So with normal corn silage, the 80% silage diet or the 55% silage diet were the lower cost of gains across all those ranges of corn prices. If we looked at some silage that was a slight drought stress, this would, again would be about a 95% value of the normal corn silage as far as feed value. We can see again the 80% silage or the 55% silage diets are, again, the low cost of gain across all those corn prices. And in this case, we actually priced the silage a little bit lower, 8 times the price of corn per bushel. So when we looked at severe drought-stressed corn silage, again, this would be about 80% of the energy value of corn. The all silage or 80% silage diets didn't quite have enough energy in this case to keep our gains up there where they need to be, and our non-feed costs started to increase our cost of gain here. But the 55% silage diet, or 20% corn, if you will, was the lowest cost of it. Now, these rations were all across 500 to 1,000 pound animals. These were not finishing rations, but probably a longer period of backgrounding than what we typically would see. So again, as corn prices increase, we might be looking at feeding higher levels of corn silage. Just want to finish up here with a couple slides looking at some diets that are feeding fairly high levels of distillers grains, and then different levels of silage inclusion in those diets. And these would be for diets fed for yearling cattle up through finishing approximately 1,350 pounds. This is some University of Nebraska research that they did a little over a year ago and was reported in the 2013 Nebraska Beef Cattle Report. The green area that I have circled there basically shows a 45% corn silage diet, 40% distillers, or a 55% corn silage diet, 40% distillers. No corn in that. What you see here is the cost of gain at three different levels of corn price, and then pricing the corn silage at 8, 8.5, or 9 times the price of corn. So in all cases there, the higher silage diets, even though performance was poorer than the higher corn diets to the left, the cost of gain was lower using these kind of assumptions on pricing the corn silage. And the other thing that we can look at in this research is the synergy between the co-products, the distillers in this case, modified distillers that they were feeding at 40% of the diet in the green circle area versus the no distillers grains and still 45% corn silage in the red circled area. You can see cost of gain, and in this case performance, definitely was lower, or the cost of gain performance was better utilizing the 40% distillers grains, 45% corn silage versus 45% corn silage and no distillers grains there in the red. So again, lots of synergy, lots of things to consider here as far as utilizing corn silage. And again, this was in a yearlings to finishing type of program. So again, another place we can look at utilizing more corn silage in the diet under these circumstances. If you have more information, or for more information, you can certainly contact one of the Extension Beef field specialists. You can see the numbers here on the screen, or you can contact the Iowa Beef Center. Number and email there is on the screen as well. Thank you for your time, and hope this was valuable to you today.